teaching, amen? So it went from apostle stuff like that. It went to prophetic stuff. But God is dealing with me about teaching. And I want you to know something. We're going to talk about the law. I got scared, didn't you? You got scared. Because we know that the law that God has given us, you know, given the children of Israel, we know that some of those don't apply to us in their practice. But what we find out is, in their implication, what it was supposed to do still applies to us. So y'all just give me a couple weeks, and y'all gonna see what I'm talking about? Because I'm not gonna try to tell you to stop eating pork. That's not what I'm gonna do. Don't y'all get worried about that. Pastor ain't leaving the pig no time soon. To let you know, the pig has been good for us. It's brought out of slavery. I'm going to stick with it. With that said, I'm not going to give it to excess. Amen? Right. Amen. You got high blood pressure. You sit there talking about pastor said I can eat it. I'm going to do what I'm going to do. But still, we want to talk about the law and what it meant. And I'm going to start off with something today in the Word of God. If you don't mind, go to the book of Psalms 119:33. Psalms 119:33. Amen. It's on the board. See, I don't know it's there. Amen. Let's go ahead and let's stand. Let's get ready for the Word of God. Let's go ahead and repeat after me. The Word is about to be preached. The lost are about to be reached. The hurting will be helped. God's promises will be kept. The enemy will be demoralized. God will be glorified. I will be edified. I believe it. I receive it. I stand on it. And I live by it. When I hear it, I will apply it, and I'll be transformed by it. Amen. Psalm 119:33 says, teach me, O Lord, the way of thy statutes, and I shall keep it unto the end. Give me understanding, and I shall keep thy law. Yea, I shall observe it with my whole heart. Going back to verse 33, it says, teach me, O Lord. Very simple this morning. Very simple word. It is just teach me. Somebody say, teach me. Amen. Who want God to teach them inside of here? Somebody say, teach me. Amen. Amen. Let us pray. If any man speak, let him speak of the oracles of God. If any man minister, let him do it as of the ability which God giveth. That God in all things may be glorified through Jesus Christ, to whom be praise and dominion forever and ever. You may be seated. That we're going to talk about teach me. Now I want you to know something, that there is nothing wrong with asking God to teach you how to live a life that is pleasing to Him. Amen. Sometimes we just think we can do it, we can just go, but God says, no, you must be taught how to live right, amen? And so scholars are not in agreement about who wrote Psalm 119, mainly because it's so long. It's the longest book in the whole Bible. And they're not really in agreement on who wrote this, but most of them attribute it to David. And that makes sense. So I'm going to tell you why that makes sense. Because if anybody would have the audacity and the honesty to say they need to be taught to do the will of God, that would be David. If anybody would be honest enough to say, Lord, I ain't getting it. I need you to teach me. It would have to be David, y'all. And so David is saying this. And so one of the major problems that plague the people of God is that we think we know how to please God and do His will, when in reality, sometimes we don't. Oh, we got quiet in the house. Some things we don't know what we should be doing. And because we don't admit that maybe God is not pleased by us and our actions, we dare not think to ask Him, Lord, teach me. Anybody ever messed up in life? Amen. Anybody thought you were doing the right thing, doing the wrong thing? And sometimes we don't want to come at the God and say, you know what? Please teach me the way. Teach me what I should be doing. And because we're not taught, we are not equipped to do what God has required of us. And I'm going to tell you something, that there is more to the law than just keeping the law. See, David is interesting because there's more to the law than just keeping the law, because David is a man after God's own heart. And the fact that he understood that there's more to the law than just keeping the law, it proved that he really is a man after God's own heart. He understood that God wanted more from us than just to keep the law. He wanted more from that. He understood that there is something deeper that is required of us, of those that seek to keep the law of God. He understood that the law was deeper than what we do on the superficial level. It's bigger than what I do on the outside. Oh, y'all better hear me. The law, the true law of God, it goes to the intentions and the heart of man, doesn't it? It gets down deep into what we really are on the inside. And David understood this because he was a man after God's heart. And the Son of God, Jesus, understood that as well. David was far beyond his time, because he even understood back in the BC times, that almost 1,000 years before Christ, he understood that, you know what? God requires more than me just doing the law. There's something that should be done on the inside by the law. And Jesus explained that, because Jesus taught something. I'm going to tell y'all this. One thing he taught that we can allow the law to change the exterior, but stop short of letting it change the inward part of us. Well, I mean, real in this house, that we can learn how to make ourselves look like we're doing well, but on the inside, we're not doing so well. And so let's go to the book of Matthew 23 and 27. It says, "Woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees and hypocrites, for ye are like whited sepulchres, as tombstones, which appear beautiful outward, but are within full of dead men's bones and all uncleanness." Now I want to tell you something. We can all be guilty of this. You want to sit there and say, "Well, that's the so-and-so sitting beside me. I wish so-and-so was here to hear that." No. That can be for all of us sometimes. That we appear good on the outside, but we dead on the inside. And let me tell you, not always about the fact that you got some sin going on. Sometimes we appear happy on the outside. We appear joyful on the outside, but on the inside there's a war going on, and we really got nothing going on inside of us that has life. And God is talking to us about that, because the word does not just come to make us presentable to man. And this is going to be something you might not want to hear, but it's the truth. The word does not just come to make you to a point where I can accept you. It's not just come to change how you look, how you dress on the outside, so now I can feel like you say. Y'all get quiet. Y'all leave me out there. But it's okay. It's not just for the fact that, "Lord, I want to be saved so I can be presentable to man." No, it's got to do a work on the inside. It comes to give us life and liberty. But when we only want to be presentable, we are tombstones that house dry bones. I'm going to tell you right now, I don't really care how you look on the outside if you get the inside right first. Because with the exterior, people can fool you with the exterior. But when the inside is right, I'm going to tell you, I had a teacher that she was going home, and my boss, my supervisor, and she was going home, and her car messed up, and you know, everybody was just driving past her. She's like she's a little older, little white woman. Everybody's driving past her. And all of a sudden, some guy in a nice car. That's something vibrating right here. And a big old nice car, we call them don'ts, right? The one that have about 26-inch rims on them. You know, that one with the big loud music bumping. And they didn't look like, you know, the people that she's around. But all of a sudden, they were the only ones who stopped. They were the only ones who stopped. Everybody else who was like her, who looked like her, who she thought would stop, did not stop. The only one who stopped with these two young black men who God just called, that she equates to be a gangster car, playing gangster music. But they were the ones that got out. Y'all better hear this. And they're the one who said, "Look, let me help you with your car. How can I fix it? Can I make sure you guys going where you need to go? Can I make sure that you're okay?" And the truth of the matter is, sometimes we see people who look right on the outside, but they won't stop and help you. Y'all better hear this, because there's something going wrong on the inside. We can all be guilty of that sometimes, aren't we? We can be guilty of the fact that we look good on the outside, so we don't want to be associated with certain people. I can't have you inside my car because I know what you do, and people know who you are. People know the kind of woman you are, know the kind of man you are, so I can't be associated with you because I want to make sure I'm presentable to man. Oh, that's poor religion. That's a worthless word, because the law of God should penetrate us to the secret parts of our lives and make us more like God, and then to transform dead men's bones to living souls. So I don't want to be a clean tombstone. I don't want to be a clean tombstone. I don't want people to say, "Oh, Pastor Baker, he's a good guy, because we're still on the outside." I want to have something on the inside as well. And so, second thing Jesus taught, and I want y'all to hear this, because this is one that we get as well, because Jesus taught that cafeteria Christianity is false Christianity. What is cafeteria Christianity? That's where you get to pick and choose what you want. You go to that line, if you don't want peas, she tells her to hell, "I don't want no peas." She ain't gonna put no peas on now. You can tell her, "I don't want that piece of chicken." She put up the chicken on there. Because that's a cafeteria, isn't it? You get to pick and choose what you want. So that's cafeteria Christianity. You can't choose what you want, and you can't leave what you don't. Give this. Matthew 23 and 23 says, "Woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites. Jesus just came out and said it, didn't he? He said, for ye pay tithe of mint and of anise and of cumin and have anointed and omitted the weightier matters of the law, judgment, mercy, and faith. These ought ye have done and not leave the other undone. The Pharisees were fine with giving the natural currency. I'll pay my tithe. I'll give my offering. But they were opposed to giving the spiritual and the emotional currency. So we got two kinds of currency, y'all. We got the money you can give, and also there's the emotional and the spiritual currency you got to give. Jesus taught that that was the weightier matters of the law. There were portions of the law that dealt with judgment of those that broke the law. And this indicts all of us, doesn't it? I'm going to tell you why I said you want to leave a judgment part. You know why? Because we don't want judgment for ourselves, and we don't want judgment for people we love, do we? Now be real in this house. No. We don't want judgment for ourselves. We want and for people that we love. And so that's why you come to pastor and say, pastor, pray. My son got in. He been put in jail. My daughter, she's in jail. She's in trouble. I need you to pray. But have they done wrong? Have they done wrong? Now, pastors, I pray plenty of people that God give them leniency, give them mercy. But you got to understand something. It's hypocritical if you want them to go to jail. If you don't want them to go to jail, but if somebody do something to you, they got to pay. All right. Oh, we got quiet in this house, didn't we? Oh, they got to pay. Oh, they can't just go around doing this. Your son's a terrorist. He got to go to jail. But what happened when it's your son? Your daughter had to do a credit card scam, and she messed up my credit doing that. But what happened when it's your daughter? Yeah. That hit hard, didn't it? Because we all want judgment for everybody else. We want mercy for ourselves, don't we? Oh, yeah, I ain't got to say amen. That's what you're preaching right there. Because Jesus taught that. You see, and there are portions that dealt with giving mercy to those that wronged us, isn't it? That God says, you know, you got to show mercy. And that indicts us as well, because we want mercy, but sometimes we find it hard to give it to other people, don't we? On the being real, we want forgiveness, we want mercy, we want you to say, don't make a big deal about what I did, but do you make a big deal about what somebody else did? Why are you still, look, there are some married couples in here. Why are you talking about that? That was 7 years ago. I'm being real in this house. We want mercy, but do we want to give mercy? And God says, no. You want to give your tithes and your offering, but you won't forgive your brother. And Jesus said, if you got a gift, you might as well leave it at the altar. Go back and get it right with your brother, and then come back and get your gift. Because sometimes we want to be white as sepulchers. We want to go around with that white envelope in our hands. But we got some people that we have not forgiven yet. Y'all believe it? Got some people that we're still holding things against. And we want mercy, but do we give mercy? Can I preach y'all real quick? And this is what the Bible says. The Bible says, if you cannot forgive your brothers, your heavenly Father can't forgive you. And you wonder why you still, oh, I'm going to preach this, you may not like it. You wonder why you still being attacked by something that happened years ago. God, I repented for that. I was through with that. Why am I still going through the same thing? Like you punching me for something that happened years ago. God said, because you never released your brother, so I can't release you. You wanted them to get judgment. You want them to get judgment, so you want them to get the wrath, so I got to give you the wrath. He said, God is not mocked. Whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. Yeah. Glory. Hallelujah. See, it's just about money, right? No. It's about forgiveness. If you can't forgive, God said, I'm going to hold it against you too. Amen. I'm going to hold it against you because you can't forgive somebody. We got to talk about that. There are portions that deal with faith. Somebody say faith. And faith costs us some stuff, don't it? You know, it costs you some stuff because faith costs us our comfort, doesn't it? God, you know, if anybody can say, I got faith, you need faith. Yeah. It's like saying, I got good sportsmanship. It's easy to say you got good sportsmanship when you win. I shake your hand if I beat you. The sportsmanship comes when I lose. Now that I said I got sportsmanship, it's easy to say you have faith when everything's going right. When you're comfortable, it's easy to have faith. But faith comes when God puts you on the cliff. Y'all better hear me. Faith comes when God puts you on the tightrope and he says, no, look at me. Don't look around you. Just look at me and keep walking. That's when you need some faith. Faith will place us in deep water sometimes, won't it? It'll put us in trying circumstances, and it causes us to trust that we don't see, it does the things that we do see. Faith is the thing that is the ability to trust in a God that you do not see versus what you do see. So God says, I'm going to take care of your bills. I'm going to take care of this. I want you to go ahead and leave this job, go to another one. He said, I'm going to take care of it. You don't see God, but you see your bills. And I'm being real. You don't see God, but you see your bills. Faith is to begin to trust in something that you cannot see. And so all these things cause spiritual and emotional currency. Somebody say currency. It will cost your spirit some currency sometimes to give somebody forgiveness when they've really done you wrong. And God been eating at you and been getting on you the whole time. And you sitting there like, Lord, I don't want to forgive that person. I know it's going to take something out of my spirit to do it. But sometimes you gotta say, Lord, I must give that spiritual currency to give them mercy. Y'all better hear this. But Lord, I want some mercy back. I must give some spiritual currency to have faith in you, even though I don't even see you. And sometimes I can't believe what you're doing. But Lord, I still have faith that whatever I give out, I can get it back. I gotta give some spiritual and some emotional currency. Am I being real?